हेलो 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 हेलो
सर अनम्यूट योर सेल्फ।
हाँ यस
गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स एंड अमंगस्ट अस वी हैव मिस्टर सूर्य नारायण राव अ फेमस लॉयर इन चिकाबुलपुर फ्रॉम कर्नाटका एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी टेकन सेशंस विद हिम एंड हिज ग्रिप ओवर द सिविल लॉ हैज ऑलवेज बीन वेल रिसीव्ड एंड द वे ही टेक्स द सेशन इन दिस एस्पेक्ट has always been seen that people love the way he takes it. And his passion to take the subjects of law is always a thing to be received and understood by everyone. And only recently he has completed 50 years in the profession. First of all, congratulations, sir, though we have shared it on the mobile. But today on the live platform, I would like to congratulate you. And today's session on probable defense in suit for partition is an important aspect of law which we would like to understand. Without taking much time, I would request the to take things forward.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Shall I begin?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, everybody. I am here today to speak to you about the probable defense in a suit for partition. Hello. Hello. So you are hearing me. Hello. Is the audio all right? Hello. Hello.
विकास मैं आपको वो बना रही आपको होस्ट बना रही मेरे को बाहर निकलना पड़ेगा
Yes, sir. No, it's fine.
My voice is all right.
Yeah. In fact, there was some difficulty at our end.
Right. Good evening, everybody. Today, I'm here to speak to you about probable defenses in a suit for partition. I've been a lawyer for the last 50 years, primarily in the trial courts, up to the district court. A defense is always built up by the trial court lawyer. For this reason, the responsibility of the lawyer who is conducting a case in the trial court is very heavy. The appellate lawyer can only build upon what is built up primarily in the pleadings before the trial court. Therefore, a very careful examination of all the facts of the case should be very clearly in your mind. A careful examination of the law on the subject should also be very clear in your mind. If any one of these two things are absent, then it would not be possible for the appellate lawyer to correct the mistake committed by the trial lawyer. Therefore, we must be most cautious in building up a defense. And what are the things that we have got to do in a suit for partition for building a good defense? When a client comes to you, the first thing you have got to do is, please write a correct genealogy of the family of the parties. Please note the dates of death of all the elders in the family, the date of birth of some of the younger members of the family would also be relevant sometimes. And in order to appreciate whether the local amendments in regard to Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act would apply or not, the dates of marriage of the daughters also would be very relevant. And in respect to the properties that are the subject matter of the suit, try to find out what are the properties ancestral, what are the properties acquired in the name of different parties to the suit, with a special emphasis on the properties that are acquired by our clients. Then try to find out what is the income from the ancestral properties and whether these ancestral properties, which constituted the nucleus for acquisition of other properties, had any superfluous income after meeting the expenses of the family. Number three, whether your client in whose name the property was acquired was in the management of the family properties at the time when the property was acquired by your client. And lastly, whether your client had any independent income to purchase those properties. And whether the client, your client who has purchased the property was a junior member of his family at the time when the property was purchased. So you try to analyze these facts correctly in writing on paper, so that these things will be very important at the time of not only preparing a defense, but also at the time when you have to cross-examine the plaintiff in the case. So after doing this, then we will have to find out whether succession has taken place in the family by virtue of Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act or Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act. If succession has opened by virtue of Section 6, then you will have to find out whether Vinita's, to what extent the latest decision of the Supreme Court in Vinita Sharma's case would be applicable. And if Section 8 applies, then things will be different. So these things, primarily you keep it in mind at the time when you try to prepare a defense. Now, there are a few questions of law which should be very clearly in your mind. You have got to find out whether the property in respect of which a partition is sought for is joint family property or self-acquired property. This is the first question that should be answered in your mind. If it is joint family property, Section 6 applies. If it is self-acquired property, Section 8 applies. There is one very important factor which many lawyers have failed to notice. And therefore, I would like to deal with that question first and then go to the other questions that arise for consideration in defending a suit for partition. Now, the property, the self-acquired property of the grandfather. The grandfather dies. After the death of the grandfather, the property comes to the hands of the father. And the grandson files a suit for partition in respect of these properties. So whether the property in the hands of the father is self-acquired property or joint family property. If it is joint family property, then the son gets a right by birth in this property, and therefore he would succeed in a suit for partition. If it is considered as self-acquired property of the father, then the grandson would have no rights in this property, the grandson or the granddaughter. They will have no right in these properties, and their right for partition would not arise because they have no right by birth in these properties, and they cannot also challenge any alienation made by the father. So that for this purpose, there are a few decisions of the Supreme Court and also the Karnataka High Court, which should always be very clear in our mind. That's where I said, see, you will have to find out the origin, how the property was originally acquired by the family is the most important thing. So therefore, if this factor is not correctly analyzed, then an essential defense in the case would be lost. So the first decision that I would like to refer to is the decision in Kapoor and others versus Chandrasen. It is 1986 Supreme Court, page 1753. In this case, the court made a reference to section 8, and this is what the Supreme Court has said, that under Hindu law, the moment a son is born, he gets a share in the father's property and becomes part of the coparcenary. His right accrues to him not on the death of the father or inheritance from the father, but with the very fact of his birth. Normally, therefore, whenever the father gets a property from whatever source, from the grandfather or from other source, be it separate property or not, his son should have a share in that, and it will become part of the joint family, and his son and grandson and other members who form the joint family with him. The court observed that this position has been affected by Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956. And therefore, after the act, when the son inherited the property, in the situation contemplated in Section 8, he does not take it as karta of his undivided family, but takes it in his individual capacity. So therefore, if the father has acquired, self-acquired property, either after 1956 or before 1956, and he dies, after the Hindu Succession Act came into force, the property would be self-acquired property in the hands of the father. That is what is made clear in the subsequent paragraphs in the judgment. As stated above, after coming into force of the Hindu Succession Act 1956, self-acquired or separate property of a male Hindu on his dying intestate devolves on his heirs in their individual capacity and not as coparcenary property. In such a situation, their children will not acquire any right by birth in such property. So therefore, and there is one other concept which you should keep in mind. Suppose the property is self-acquired property in the funds of the father, though acquired from the grandfather. Let us suppose the father dies. If the father dies and the property is inherited by the grandson, that property will be self-acquired property in the hands of the grandson, because the property was self-acquired property in the hands of the father. Therefore, the similar thing happens in the case of great-grandsons also. Therefore, if this factor is clearly kept in mind, a large number of properties acquired by the family after 1956 would partake the character of self-acquired properties, and therefore alienations made by the father or their ancestors could not be challenged at all by the succeeding generations, as the property would be self-acquired property in the hands of the father. And this principle is affirmed by the Supreme Court in a large number of decisions. That is, AIR 1987 Supreme Court, page 558, Yudhishthir versus Ashok Kumar. In fact, I would only make a reference to paragraph 10 of the decision of the Supreme Court at page 562. This is what they have said in Yudhishthir's case. Normally, therefore, when the father gets a property from whatever source, from the grandfather or from other source, be it separate property or not, his son should have a share in that, and it would become part of the joint family of his son and grandson and other members who form joint family with him. This court observed that this position has been affected by Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956, and therefore, after the Act, when the son inherited the property in the situation contemplated in Section 8, he does not take it as karta of his own undivided family, but takes it in his individual capacity. Then a reference is also made to Mains Hindu law in this decision, and this is how it reads. In view to a similar effect is the observation of the learned author of Mains Hindu law, 12th edition, at page 919. In that view of the matter, it would be difficult to fold that property which devolve on a Hindu under Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956 would be HUF in the hands of his sons. If that is the position, the property, this sentence is very important. If that is the position, then the property which devolved upon the father of the respondent in the instant case on the demise of the grandfather could not be said to be HUF property. Then there are a few other decisions of the Supreme Court about which some courts have expressed slightly a different opinion, but if the facts of the case are looked into, it is in consonance with these two decisions. The other decision is 2006, 8 SCC, page 581, Sheila Devi and others versus Lal Chand and others. That was a case where succession to properties of one Babu Lal was involved. And if section paragraph 11 of the judgment is carefully read, the court has clearly held that the properties in the hands of Babu Lal and his brothers were joint family properties. So succession was being worked out in respect of Babu Lal's properties. And the court clearly came to the conclusion that Babu Lal, that the property in his hands were joint family properties. Therefore, in that view of the matter, in this particular case, the court applied Section 6 and not Section 8, because succession was being worked out for the property of Babu Lal, in whose hands the properties were joint family properties. So under the, and therefore Section 8 was not applied. In fact, there is one other decision of the Supreme Court reported in AIR 2008 Supreme Court 1490, Banwar Singh versus Puran and others. In fact, a property was sold by the father, and that was questioned by the sons by filing a suit for partition. Plaintiff's father and his three sisters, they had inherited this property from their father. So therefore, the court held that the property loses the character of joint family properties because they were acquired under Section 8 on succession to the father. Therefore, they held that it was Section 8 that was applicable. The property in the hands of the father was the property which was the self-acquired property, and therefore the son cannot challenge the alienation, and the suit was rightly dismissed. And in fact, the judgment in the two cases, that is Sheila Devi's case and Banwar Singh's case, both are rendered by Justice S.P. Sinha. So therefore, there is room for some confusion. The confusion will be clear only if the facts of the case are kept in mind and not otherwise. Then there is another decision of the Supreme Court in Anar Devi versus Parameshwari Devi and others. It is Civil Appeal number 4171 bar 2006, disposed of on 18-9-2006. See, that was a case where properties belonging to one Nagarmal was in question. The court came to the conclusion that the properties in the hands of Nagarmal was ancestral properties and not self-acquired properties, and therefore the court held that the grandson had a right in these properties because the succession to Nagarmal's property was being in question in the case before the Supreme Court. Then the last, the very recent decision of the Supreme Court is one reported in 2019 SAR Civil 809, Ashroor Singh versus Harpal Kaur and others. It's a decision of Justice Indira Banerjee, and the entire law is put in two sentences at para 7.5 at page 816 of the reports. This is what they have said after the Hindu Succession Act came into force. This position has undergone a change post 1956. If a person inherits a self-acquired property from the paternal ancestor, the said property becomes his self-acquired property and does not remain copartnery property. And they make a distinction. They make the distinction very clear. If the grandfather who had acquired the property died prior to 1956, then it would be ancestral in the hands of the father. If he died subsequent to 1956 and the succession opened subsequent to 1956, then it would be self-acquired property in the father. So in that particular case, what had happened was the grandfather died prior to 1956. Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act had no application in the case because he died prior to the Hindu Succession Act. Therefore, the court held in the fact situation of that particular case, the property was not self-acquired property in the hands of the father, and therefore the grandson would have a right in these properties. And that apart, I would make only a reference to a few decisions of the Supreme Court and Karnataka High Court, where these principles are affirmed by making a reference to the earlier decisions of the Supreme Court. They are 2008, one Karnataka Law Journal, page 482, Mallika and others versus Chandrappa and others. In this particular case, a review, in fact, the court had erred in holding that the property acquired by the father on succession to the grandfather was joint family property. The court had made a mistake. A petition for review was filed and Chandrasen's case was relied upon. The court allowed the review petition, warned the mistake, and ultimately dismissed the suit. This is in Mallika's case. Then there is a division bench decision of the Karnataka High Court. In 2015, one Karnataka Law Journal, page 65, Radha versus Venkatappa, and the law is discussed at page 68 of the reports. Then the last decision of the Karnataka High Court is the one reported in 2016, 5 KCCR, page 1273. So that is another decision, Shakuntala versus Basavaraj, where all the previous decisions have been referred to and the principle is affirmed by the Karnataka High Court. Then only one other decision of Delhi High Court, that is AIR 2008 Delhi, page 40. They have clearly said grandson or granddaughter will have no share in the property left by the grandfather during the lifetime of the father. So therefore, it is the property is acquired by the father, not on account of unobstructed heritage, but of obstructed heritage. And therefore, Section 8 would apply and the property would be self-acquired property in the hands of the father. So if this principle of law is kept in mind, and if the facts of the case are analyzed, it would be possible for us to defend our client effectively, because most of the litigation that comes would be in respect of properties which are acquired after 1950s. That's almost 75 years from now. So therefore, if this is kept in mind, in a large number of cases, we can put the case outside the purview of Section 6 and put it in Section 8, so that we can defend the purchasers of properties from the father effectively. Then the next question I would like to deal with is, I would like to make a reference to Section 19 of the Hindu Succession Act. In fact, this provision has not been correctly referred to and understood by most of us. We must have a close reading of this section. If two or more heirs succeed together to the property of an interstate, they shall take the property, save as otherwise expressly provided in the Act, per capita and not per strips. Then, as tenants in common and not as joint tenants. This is one of the most important things. In fact, in the while making a reference to Section 8 also, say this, if this section also could be applied. Because this section says where, in fact, the word used is succeed and intestate. That is, those are the two qualifications required for application of this section. The word used is not inherits, it is succeeds. So therefore, Section 19 applies both to Section 6 and also to Section 8. And The only qualification is that the person whose succession is in question must have died intestate. That is, he should not have left a will. So therefore, if the where the property of the father is acquired by the children, by the sons and daughters, they acquire it not as joint tenants, but as tenants in common. If they acquire the property as tenants in common, then what happens is the property would be self-acquired in their hands, because the character of the property is not joint tenancy, but tenancy in common. Therefore, this principle will have got to be correctly in mind while assessing the fact situation in each one of the cases. Then, this section 9 also applies to succession under section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act. This is made clear in two decisions of the Supreme Court. That is, AIR 2016 Supreme Court 1169, that is Uttam versus Subhat, and another decision reported in 2020 SAR Civil 127. In fact, in the decision of Justice Nariman in Uttam versus Subhag Singh, the entire law prior to the amendment of section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act 2005 has been dealt with. And this is what the Supreme Court has said. In fact, the Supreme Court has laid down the principles in very crisp language as far as the law prior to 2005. This is what the Supreme Court has said. I repeat the words of the Supreme Court. When a male Hindu dies after the commencement of the Hindu Succession Act 1956, having at the time of his death an interest in Mithaksharaka personally, his interest in the property will devolve by survivorship upon the surviving members of the coparsonary. To proposition 1, that is survivorship, an exception is contained in section 30, explanation of the act, making it clear that notwithstanding anything contained in the act, the interest of a male Hindu in Mithakshara coparsonary is property that can be disposed of by him by will or other testamentary succession. A second exception is engrafted to proposition 1 is contained in the proviso to section 6, which states that if such a male Hindu had died leaving behind a female relative specified in clause 1 of the schedule, or a male relative specified in that clause who climbs through such female relative surviving him, then the interest of the deceased in the coparsonary property would devolve by testamentary or interstate succession and not by survivorship. In order to determine the share of a Hindu male coparsoner who is governed by section 6 proviso, a partition is effected by operation of law, always called as notional partition, immediately before his death. In this partition, all the coparsoners and the male Hindu's widow get a share in the joint family property. On the application of section 8 of the act, either by reason of the death of a male Hindu leaving self-acquired property, or by application of section 6, such property would devolve only by intestacy and not by survivorship. On a conjoint reading, this is what is important. This is the essence of all these principles. On a conjoint reading of section 4, 8, and 19 of the Act, about which I made a reference earlier, after joint family property has been distributed, in accordance with section 8, on the principles of interstacy, the joint family property ceases to be joint family property in the hands of various persons who have succeeded to it as they hold the property as tenants in common and not as joint tenants. So this one principle would make a world of difference. I'll give you a small illustration. A case where the property is ancestral in the hands of the father. The father dies after 1956, leaving behind him two sons, two daughters, and say, we will say, two grandsons who were dead, one grandson born after the partition, second grandson who had died before the partition. You imagine a situation like that. So therefore, what the Supreme Court has said, if these properties are partitioned after the death of the grandfather, the three sons, after the 2005 Act, the two sons and the two daughters, all of them get an equal share. So therefore, 1/4 each, 1/4 each. So therefore, the ancestral property is acquired by the father and his brother and sisters after the death of the grandfather. What is the character of this property in the hands of the father? The character of the property in the hands of the father is, according to the Supreme Court, and by a close reading of Section 19, it would be self-acquired property in the hands of these people, though they have acquired joint family property in the hands of the father after the death of the father. They say that these people succeed to the property not as joint tenants, but as tenants in common. Therefore, when once the property is acquired in the character of tenancy in common, the property in their hands would be impressed with the character of being self-acquired properties. So suppose on the date of the partition, if the son is alive, the son also would get a right by birth. So therefore, the father's 1/4 share would be again shared between the father and the son, and the father would get a 1/8 share and the son would get a 1/8 share. So let us suppose the son was not alive on the date of death of the father. Then the son did not get a right at a partition at all, because he was not alive on the date when the grandfather died. So therefore, even in respect of ancestral properties, the grandson would not get any right in the property if he was not born on the date when the grandfather died, or if he had already died before the death of the grandfather. So therefore, in this case, what happened was the property belonged to the grandfather. The grandson filed a suit for partition. Ultimately, what the Supreme Court said was, on the date when the grandfather died, the grandson was not alive at all. Therefore, the property, the joint family property, succeeded by the father after the death of the grandfather, converted itself into the character of a self-acquired property, and the alienation made by the father could not be challenged, and the suit was ultimately dismissed by the Supreme Court. In fact, without making a detailed reference to Uttam's case, the Supreme Court in one other case, in 2020, SAR Civil 127, this is Radhabai versus Ramanarayan. In this case, they made a reference to one other case of the Supreme Court reported in 2008, Supreme Court 2489. And this is Hardio Roy versus Shakuntala Devi. In fact, that was the first case where this principle was actually deduced. And this Hardio Roy's case is not referred to in Uttamchand's case. And Uttamchand's case is also not referred to in this Radhabai's case. But the principle they have laid down is very clear. And by making a reference to this Hardio Roy's case, this is what the Supreme Court has said, quoting from Hardio Roy's case. Once the share of a co-partner is determined, so that is when the father dies, the share of the co-partner gets determined. It ceases to be co-partnership property. When once there is a partition, whatever be its nature, it could be by issue of a notice, it could be by filing a suit, and it could be by the death of the grandfather. So therefore, when once the share of the co-partner gets determined, it is at all the persons who are alive on that date alone would get a right in these properties. If the grandsons are subsequently born, if they are not alive on the date when the grandfather died, they cannot file a suit for partition and claim a share even in the property acquired by their father on succession to the grandfather, in whose hands the property was joint family property. So therefore, this is what the Supreme Court has said, referring to Hardio Roy's case. I read the wordings of the Supreme Court. Once the share of the co-partner is determined, it ceases to be co-partnership property. The parties in such an event does not possess the property as joint tenants because of application of Section 19 of the Hindu Succession Act, but as tenants in common. The decision of this court in SBI, therefore, is not applicable to the present case. Then the next sentence is most important. When a co-partner takes a definite share in the property, he is the owner of the share. And as such, he can alienate the same by sale or mortgage in the same manner as he can dispose of separate property. So therefore, the ancestral property gets converted into self-acquired property in the hands of the various co-partners when once succession opens by reason of death or by reason of a partition, which is caused by issue of a notice or by filing a suit for partition. This concept has to be very clearly kept in mind. In this case also, they found that the person who had filed a suit was not entitled to challenge the share, the alienations made by his father, Jagat Singh, and therefore their lordships ultimately held that the suit would deserve to be dismissed. Then, coming to, there is one other decision of the Andhra Pradesh High Court. In fact, the first principle which I have stated, they extend the principle further. So, what the Andhra Pradesh High Court has said, in 1996, two CCC, civil court cases, Andhra Pradesh, that is, Musani Devi Prasad versus Musani Bhavani and others. Here, what happened was, the property was ancestral in the hands of the father, grandfather. The grandfather died. Let us suppose the grandfather has two sons. So therefore, when once the grandfather died, there was a notional partition. The grandfather acquired a one-third share. The two sons also acquired a one-third share each. then what happens is the share of the father is again split by application of section 8. So therefore, the father's share is acquired by the two sons on succession by inheritance by application of section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act, and they derive a 1/6 share on succession to the father. So the Andhra Pradesh High Court has held that the 1/3 share which was acquired by the sons by virtue of their right by birth would be ancestral property in their hands. But the 1/6 share which they acquired from the father on succession to the father by application of section 8, the 1/6 share would be self-acquired in the hands of the father. So therefore, though in totality, they get a 1/3 and 1/6 share, 1/3 share would be ancestral in their hands. 1/6 share would be self-acquired property in their hands. So therefore, the grandson could challenge any alienation made by the father only in respect of the 1/3 share and not the 1/6 share. So therefore, this is how the principle has been further extended by the Andhra Pradesh High Court in 1996 to civil court cases. Then the next most important question is, in all the cases that we appear in the courts, what happens is that the properties are acquired in the name of the manager, in the name of junior members of the family, in the name of the women folk of the family and all that. So, and these properties many times would have been alienated, and we appear for the purchasers. Then the most important attack that we have got to make is that how the property was acquired. If we are able to convince the court that the property was acquired without detriment to the joint family estate, then it will be self-acquired property in the hands of those co-partners, and therefore the alienation cannot be challenged. So therefore, what are the areas that we should focus upon in building a defense like this? The first thing is, we should find out what are admittedly joint family properties. Number two, whether there is sufficient income from these properties. And after the expenses of the family are made, whether there is any surplus out of which these properties could have been purchased. And the name, the person in whose name the property is acquired, whether that person was actually in the management of the assets of the joint family, and whether the income of the joint family was flowing into his hands. This is another important question that had to be kept in mind. So therefore, when once the nucleus is established, that is not sufficient. Further, it has three other conditions will have got to be proved. The nucleus was yielding and it would leave sufficient surplus after the expenses of the family are met. Number two, that income was flowing into the hands of the person who has purchased the property. So if these things are not established, then we would be able to sustain that the property is not does not belong to the joint family, and it is this self-acquired property of the person who has sold the property to our client. So therefore, in one decision of the Supreme Court, that is Srinivasa Kanungu's case, a reference to which is made in AIR 2003, Supreme Court 3800. in this decision, that is D.S. Lakshmaya versus L. Balasubramanian. In fact, I would like to make a few refer to a few portions of this judgment. In this case, what happened was two properties of the family were involved. One property was acquired in the name of one of the members of the joint family. The second property was admittedly joint family properties. It consisted of only 15 guntas of land. The High Court came to the conclusion that no evidence was placed before the court by the person who was who had acquired the property, that he had independent income. Therefore, the court came to the conclusion that the property acquired in the name of one of the members of the family was also joint family property. There was no evidence of income. In fact, what was the income that these 15 guntas would have given? There was absolutely no evidence of income in the case. Therefore, the Supreme Court, by making a reference to the decision of Srinivasa Krishna Rao Kanungo versus Narayan Devji Kanungo, EIR 1954 Supreme Court 379. In fact, this is what I make a reference to paragraph 10 of the decision. In Srinivasa Krishna Rao Kanungo versus Narayan Devji Kanungo and others, EIR 1954 Supreme Court 379, the contention that was urged on behalf of the appellant was that the burden was wrongly cast on the plaintiff of proving that the acquisition of the property were made with the aid of joint family funds, the argument being that as the family admittedly possessed the ancestral Vatan lands to the extent of 56 acres. So therefore, 56 acres of land was available as nucleus in the case. That was the evidence placed. But there was no evidence of income from this 56 acres of land. Therefore, this is how the Supreme Court has said. It must be presumed, that was the argument, because there were 56 acres of land, it must be presumed that the acquisitions were made with the aid of joint family funds, and therefore the burden lay on the defendants who claimed that they were self-acquisitions to establish that they were made without the aid of joint family funds. Then the next portion is, there was no satisfactory evidence about the income which these lands were yielding at the material time. So therefore, this is one very important question which should always be in our mind, whether the plaintiff has let in any evidence in regard to the income. If there is absence of material in the case to show that there was income from ancestral lands, then the plaintiff cannot succeed at all, in spite of the fact that the defendants have not proved that they have independent income of their own. I'll read further. Under these circumstances, noting with approval the aforesaid Privy Council decision, it was held that whether the evidence adduced by the plaintiff was sufficient to shift the burden which initially rested on him to establish that there was adequate nucleus out of which the acquisition could have been made, is one of fact depending on the nature and extent of the nucleus. The important thing to consider is the income which the nucleus yields. A building in the occupation of the members of the family and yielding no income could not be nucleus out of which the acquisition could be made, even though it might be of considerable value. Say the property may be worth 10 crores. If the members of the family are living in that property, it does not yield any income. Therefore, merely by putting evidence to show that the family owned a house of 10 crores, it does not constitute nucleus. So therefore, in making a cross examination of the plaintiff, you have got to keep in mind the property would have been acquired long back. Then you should ask the person in the box, the plaintiff, what is the date of your birth? If you are able to establish that she was a child or she was not born at all at the time when the property was acquired, and you are able to get an answer to say that she has no personal knowledge of the income of the family at the time when the property was acquired, that would be a big thing in your favor. You would be able to get the suit dismissed to say that the property is self-acquired property and not joint family property. So therefore, if the law is not clearly in your mind, as a trial lawyer, your cross-examination for hours and hours would not do. You must try to find out whether the witness before the court has personal knowledge. You must ask them whether they were present at the time when the property was purchased. What was the consideration for the purchase of the property? How this amount was mobilized by the person who purchased the property for purchasing this property. So therefore, see, cross-examination is the not. You must know where to strike. Unless this is not properly done, you will not be able to defend your client properly. So therefore, they make a reference. So therefore, see, as a plaintiff, there is one other contention which I can always raise. In fact, as a plaintiff, the plaintiff must say that these are the ancestral properties. The income was in surplus. It was much in excess of the expenditure of the family. The person who has purchased the property was in the management of the affairs of the family. This fund is actually made use of for the purchase of this property. So if this pleading is not there, you can make use of that. A plea which is not supported by the pleadings would not be entertained by the court. Therefore, see, the whatever weaknesses are in the case of the plaintiff. In fact, I have, in my 50 years of practice, I have found that insufficient knowledge of facts of the case, insufficient knowledge of the correct law on the point by the opponent, we have been able to succeed in many cases, though the case could have been put on a sound footing, both in the pleadings and also in the evidence. The witnesses who have actually witnessed the transaction, who are responsible for mobilizing the money for the transaction, they should have been examined. Otherwise, how can the income be proved without examining these people? So therefore, when you strike, you should strike the case at the right point. Otherwise, you will not be able to defend the case. So this is another important factor which has to be kept in mind. Then I would make a reference to a few other portions in the judgment, because this is, in fact, I want all of you to read this judgment very carefully. This makes a reference to a few previous decisions, lays down the law correctly, and correct exposition is made. In fact, their lordships have said that the income from the admitted joint family property is not established. It does not matter, even if the person who has purchased the property has not shown that he had any separate income for himself, even then the plaintiff would not be entitled to succeed. In fact, they make a reference to another decision in this in D.S. Lakshmaya's case, and this is I read from the decision of the Supreme Court. This is, however, subject to the limitation that the joint family must be that the joint family property must be such with the aid of which the property in question could have been acquired. It has been held that the important thing to consider is the income which the nucleus yields. these sentences must always be in your mind. They must be appearing in every dealing with the case in every aspect. Now, and the last portion I would like to refer to in the judgment is at paragraph 20. In the present case, respondents have not led any evidence on the aforesaid aspect. So there was no evidence of income. And therefore, it cannot be held that the first appellant blended item one property into the joint family. There was a plea of blending and that was also rejected in that case. So therefore, and this principle has been referred to, in fact, a number of decisions of the Supreme Court are there, and there I would only give you the citations of those decisions. Yeah, that is AIR 1960 Supreme Court, page 335, Rukma Bhai versus Lakshmi Narayan. Then the next is the decision is AIR 1969 Supreme Court 1076 Mudigowda versus Ramachandra. Then AIR 2004 Karnataka 409. In fact, I would like to read a passage from this Mudigowda's decision. There is no presumption that a joint family, merely because it is joint, possesses any joint property. The burden of proving that any property is joint family property is therefore, in the first instance, upon the person who claims it is coparcenary property. But if the possession of nucleus of the joint family is admitted or proved, any acquisition made by a member of the joint family is presumed to be joint family property. This is, however, subject to the limitation that the joint family property must be such. So this is what is most important. Must be such that with its aid, the property in question could have been acquired. If possession of adequate nucleus is shown, so then the owner shifts to the person who claims that the property as self-acquired property to affirmatively establish the same. Then there is one more decision of the Karnataka High Court in ILR 1993 Karnataka, page 1182, Dr. Humphrey versus Renukappa. Initial burden of existence of sufficient family property to form nucleus is always on the plaintiff. This question of fact should be proved by direct and circumstantial evidence, which is clear, unequivocal, and clinching. So this is what is important. Without a finding as to requisite nucleus traceable to family asset, it is not possible to hold earnings, savings, or acquisitions by a person who is a member of the joint family belongs to the entire family. Then 2008 KCCR short notes 184, that is Revamma versus Bhashasab. The wide proposition that once the ancestral nucleus is proved or admitted, the onus is on the member to prove that the property acquired was his self-acquisition cannot be accepted as correct. Merely proving useless is not important. The existence of some nucleus is not the sole criterion to impress the subsequent acquisition with joint family character. What is required to be shown is that the family had, as a result of the nucleus, sufficient surplus income from out of which the subsequent acquisition could be made. The burden is always upon the person who claims that a particular property is joint family property. So therefore, invariably, in every case of partition, we find that the normal defense that we take is that the property acquired by a particular member is his self-acquired property and not joint family property. So therefore, if these principles are properly kept in mind, and you must always say in your defense, the joint family did not have any superfluous income out of which the property in question could have been acquired. The property in question was acquired without detriment to the joint family estate. These two sentences must invariably find a place in your defense. Unless your defense is strong, strongly supported by the pleadings, we will not be able to support the case at the trial. Therefore, this is very important that we should always keep in mind in defending clients in a suit for partition. Then there is one other important aspect of the matter which we may keep in mind. That is, suppose the father dies. The father has two sons and two daughters. The property is self-acquired property of the father. Then the four sons acquire the property on succession to the father after 1956. Therefore, the property in the hands of the sons, as I have already explained, would be self-acquired property in these hands. Then, with this property, which all these two sons and two daughters have acquired, with the income from those properties, they purchase other properties. What would be the character of those properties? So therefore, the property in the hands of the father, his brother and sisters, they were only joint property and they were not joint family property. And if the income from these joint properties is pooled and a new property is acquired, the new property does not become joint family property. It only becomes joint property. In fact, this question has been discussed by the Honorable Supreme Court in a decision reported in six Supreme Court cases, 523. That is P. Periyasamy versus P. Periyathambi. In fact, they discussed, I would only read the in view of the interpretation put by the full bench of the Madras High Court, that the sons in such a situation would get self-acquired property of their father by inheritance, having the status as tenants in common, which I have already explained. They could not thus treat such properties in their hands, even though joint in enjoyment, as joint family properties. They are jointly enjoying, but it has not become joint family properties. Likewise, the income derived therefrom, if employed to purchase another property, would not cloak the acquisition with the character of joint Hindu family property, but it may otherwise be joint properties. So therefore, it does not become joint family properties, it is joint properties only. Suppose if all of them together sell the property, or if all of them partition the property and each of them take a share, then that share which they get of the property which they have acquired from joint funds would be their individual property. The son cannot claim a share in these properties. So therefore, these principles of law, if they are clearly in our mind, then we can certainly build up a very good defense in this case. And therefore, I would say that the law on the question will have got to be correctly in their mind. In fact, Mr. Chatrath, hello, Mr. Chatrath, hello, can I close now and comment?
Yes, sir, definitely.
So I'll continue this because it will take another more than an hour for me to deal with the other questions.
Yeah.
So therefore, I'll meet on some other day.
I've seen that you can do the sessions breathlessly.
Pardon?
I've seen that you can take the sessions breathlessly. With ease, you explain the law.
Sir.
So this is, what is the difference between tenancy in common and joint tenants?
See, tenancy in common and joint tenancy is this. In tenancy in common, there is what is called PITT, PIT, unity of possession, interest, transfer and title. If all this unity is not there in any one of them, then it would be tenancy in common. If it is a joint tenancy, the property would become joint family property. If it is not joint tenancy, if there is tenancy in common, the share is predicated. The share does not go up or come down. The share is predicated, and therefore, in a tenancy in common, it would be the individual property of the persons who are jointly holding the property.
If the father purchased properties out of his business in the name of wife and son, after the demise of the father, can a father claim partition against mother? No, can a daughter claim partition against mother and brother?
One thing is, now we will have to examine the position with Binami Transactions Act in mind. So by virtue of the provisions of the Binami Transaction Act, if the property is purchased in the name of the sons by the income provided by the father could have even felt that he wanted to give the property. Therefore, he might have purchased the property in the name of the son. In fact, in one of the Supreme Court cases which I have read, the Supreme Court has said where the property was purchased in the name of the wife, the entire consideration flowed from the account of the father. It was claimed that the property was joint family property. The Supreme Court said, whether Binami Transaction Act applies or not, the father must have intended a gift of this property. Therefore, he must have given money for the property being purchased in the name of the wife. Therefore, normally in such a situation, it is very, very difficult for the plaintiff to succeed in a suit for partition in a case like this. Hello. I'm not hearing you.
I said these were the only two questions which had been posted on the group.
Right.
And on the YouTube, there's none. So thank you, everyone. Stay safe and stay blessed. I will take time from Mr. Surya Narayan, and then we will share it on the social media as to on what date it will be done. Thank you. Stay safe. Stay blessed. And tomorrow we will be having session with Mr. Uday Hola on how to read the Bear Act statutes and rules. Do stay connected with us tomorrow at 6 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.